That was abrupt. Good morning. Glad to be back with you guys this morning. Interestingly enough, we're talking a little bit about a wedding, and me and my wife just got back from two weddings, so I feel like I have a little bit of understanding here. But before we get into the wedding, I want you to imagine a man who just got married, okay? But this man, he gets married to a woman, but yet he lives as though nothing has changed. So he's married, made a commitment before God and his family, his church, and yet he lives as though nothing's changed. He's going out with all his buddies on the weekend, doesn't bother to talk to his wife first. We know how that would go, don't we? All right, he forgets a couple of really important dates, an anniversary here, a birthday there, and he lives as though there was never really a relationship there, or at least he's relating to this woman who's now his wife the same way he used to when they were dating, but no more because now they're married. You see, he lives though business is as usual, but when you get married, it changes the relationship, doesn't it? Here we were living life this way. A covenant comes into play where I'm before my future wife and those that are witnesses, and we create a new relationship where things change, and they must change, and the way that we relate to each other changes. It's not business as usual. Well, when Jesus arrives on the scene, it isn't business as usual. Everything changed, including the way that we relate to God. Did God change? No. Did we necessarily change? No, we still have a sin nature. Christ came to save us from that. But the way that we express our relationship with God changed, particularly when we think about the Old Covenant in the Old Testament and the New Covenant. Aren't we glad that we don't have to go to the temple in Jerusalem and sacrifice animals? Are you glad about that? I'm glad about that. I'm glad that my relationship with God has changed quite a bit, particularly when you think of the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. Well, really, that's what we're talking about this morning in Matthew 9. If you would open up your Bible to Matthew 9, that would be wonderful. Starting there in verse 14. As you are, I can sum it up in a preaching point this way. When we think about Christ and his arrival here on earth, we understand this, that the arrival of Christ requires you to assess the value of every spiritual practice in light of how it relates to the person and work of Christ. So everything that you do, doesn't matter if you were a Jewish person in the past or whether you were just a pagan and Gentile like most of us in this room, what we have to do is say, what are we doing, and does it actually relate to our relationship with Christ, and how does it do it? That's how we have to inform the way that we live our life in this age. Does it enhance my relationship with Christ? Does it relate to my relationship with Christ? Maybe there are some things that I was doing that I don't need to be doing anymore, or maybe there are some things that aren't necessarily wrong, but they need to be reoriented toward Christ. We see that here in the text. And the problem is, if you don't do this, and the disciples of John the Baptist and the Pharisees are going to find out shortly, but if you don't do this, you may be following cultural and religious traditions that have nothing to do with biblical Christianity. Now, we look in our culture and we see that, don't we? We see at least that in our culture. There's people doing things for religious reasons that have nothing to do with biblical Christianity. They have nothing to do with thus saith the Lord. They do things just because culture said to do it. Or my pastor just told me to do it. Well, where does the Bible say that? Well, it doesn't. Then why are we doing it? The question is are we evaluating the things that we're doing? Because the things that we have in front of us that God has called us to do, we have rites and rituals in the Christian life. You must believe it, right? Baptism, Lord's Supper, many things like that. And God calls us to do that because it frames for us and informs us how we relate newly to God in Christ, right? That's what baptism is. It's a symbol of how we relate to a new life in Christ. The Lord's Supper, it's a symbol of how we relate to God through Christ. Corporate worship, it's now how we, not as individuals, but as a body of sons and daughters, relate to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We still have plenty of things that we recognize that we must be doing in the Christian life, but we do it because it defines how we relate to Christ. Well, that's the problem that needs to be solved in the text. and I trust needs to be solved in some manner in your own life as you're asking yourself, what are you doing and why are you doing it when it comes to the habits and rituals in your own life, whether it's going out to the lake every Sunday because that's your sanctuary, which is completely out of bounds, or why have I been doing this thing in church my whole life when actually Scripture never once teaches those things? Well, let's at least get an introductory to that concept here as we open up, starting in verse 14 of Matthew chapter 9. Then the disciples of John, remember this is John the Baptist, by this point he's arrested, imprisoned because of his challenge to the king. He disagreed with the way that he was marrying a woman that he shouldn't have in adultery. Nevertheless, John the Baptist is imprisoned, and now some of John's disciples, those that you were introduced to early on in the Gospel of Matthew when John the Baptist was baptizing people down at the Jordan River. If you know John the Baptist, he's not a Baptist, he baptized, right? That's what he did. He's not a denominational affiliate, he's an individual who baptized people there at the Jordan. And so here, there he was at the Jordan baptizing people, and people came around him and began following John. Was not an odd thing to do in the first century. A lot of rabbis, a lot of followers, a lot of disciples followed these rabbis around. John the Baptist was one of those. And here, John the Baptist is arrested, and here are some of John's disciples, and they come to Jesus and they say, "Why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples, they don't fast?" Now, it's important to at least understand a foundational matrix of fasting, right? There was a lot of reasons people fasted in the Old Testament. There's only one command of regular annual fasting in the Mosaic Law, and that was the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. That's when all of the nation of Israel came together. And they sacrificed Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement. That was the day where they all sought forgiveness from God. And that's when the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies and he would seek forgiveness for his sins and then for the sins on behalf of the whole nation. And they would sacrifice. And that system of ceremonial sacrifice was also included in that, a time of national fasting for the forgiveness of sins. Now, there were other kinds of fasting individuals did. People fasted because they were mourning. I mean, you and I do the same thing often, don't it? When something so bad and so sad happens in our life, and we just say, I can't eat right now, right? I mean, we recognize we do the same thing, even if we don't strictly do it for religious reasons. There are times in our life where we don't eat because we're mourning. They also were people which was often the case you see in Scripture, people fasting because of their remorse for sin. Number of other things, but there are times also when people fasted because kings and leaders told them to fast. You remember this in Nineveh, don't you? When Jonah goes to Nineveh and they recognize that they're sinful because Jonah says, you're going to perish if you don't repent, and they mourn over their sin, and the king says, everybody's fasting. We see the same thing in the book of Esther called a national fast. So there are times where you also see fasting done in that way. But by the first century, this is the time of Jesus and the Pharisees and the disciples of John, fasting became a symbol of piety. It became one of those symbols of thou, or how do you say me in Old English? I don't know. Me art holy. There you go. All right, I'm holy, I'm godly, I'm the one, right? I'm doing something that should show everybody that I worship God. Now, this is the problem that we saw earlier in the Gospel of Matthew, wasn't it? When Jesus said, when you fast, stop doing it publicly. You remember that? That's partly why, because if fasting was supposed to show how pious I am, well, I can't do that in secret, and they're not going to know how pious I am. I got to do this publicly so people know how much I sacrificed for God. And Jesus said, no. Fasts are supposed to be private, not even a public affair, really. It needs to be something that you do privately. So they're not actually a good proof for your proof of piety. But by the first century, this definitely became the case. Anyone who loved God should fast regularly. As a matter of fact, by this time, the Pharisees fasted every week, Mondays and Thursdays. Mondays and Thursdays, every single week, they fasted just to show how pious and godly that they were, at least on the outside. So I say all that so that you can see why the disciples of John were asking this question. because it would be considered very unusual for people to be looking at this group of people who claim to live righteous lives, who claim to love God, and this Jesus, who's the Messiah, who many are starting to understand, says he's the Son of God and the one to come, the anointed one, but yet they see that they're forsaking regular weekly fasting. Right? If we're supposed to say, well, the godly ones are the one fasting, but you guys, you're not fasting. So they're trying to figure out how do I validate this in my understanding of their theology when Jesus and disciples weren't fasting, but that's just what godly people do. They fast. And then Jesus said in the beginning of verse 15, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? You see, you at least have to agree to this much. People aren't fasting when things are just going awesome, right? You never thought when the best things going on in your life, I mean, you were just up here on cloud nine and you say, you know what I should do today? I should fast, right? You're just not thinking of that. Fasting often had to do with mourning. It had to do with I'm sacrificing because there's things in my life right now that aren't pleasing to me and I'm longing for God and I do not feel filled with God. I am living in my life and maybe in some sense in my sin separated from God, and my fast is a part of my mourning. It's a part of me seeking the Lord, right? That's what fasting generally is. And then Jesus is saying, fasting, when these guests, my disciples, the people around me, these wedding guests, how are they going to mourn when the bridegroom is with them? I told you, me and my wife went to two weddings over the past couple of days, and as I've been studying this text, I took my pen and pad around, and I was watching and seeing. I was like, did I see anybody fasting in here? Did I see anybody mourning in here? I'm looking, I'm empty. There's not a name on there. Because at these weddings, people were celebrating. Some of them a little too much, but they were celebrating. And they were dancing, they were laughing, they were talking, they were hugging, they were clapping, and they were cheering, because that's what you do when you go to a wedding. You celebrate. And Jesus, what I love that he's doing, he's just showing you this demarcation in time of saying, fasting has its place, but when I'm here, when the king is in the room, when Jesus is there, this is not time to mourn. This is time to celebrate. I mean, he's starting to say, okay, you did these rituals and these rites and these things in old Judaism, but I have come and I'm greater than these things. I'm greater than the law. I fulfilled them in me. Now all these things find their fulfillment in me, and if they must continue, they find their meaning in me. Did you hear that? Either they've been fulfilled in Christ and they're obsolete, which we'll get to, or if they are continuing, things like fasting does continue to this day, they find their meaning in Christ, and that's why we do them. Did you hear that? Now, when we reread this, Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests fast and mourn when the bridegroom is in the room? No, we're not going to fast when Jesus is here. We're going to celebrate, because that's what we do in our new relationship with Christ. When Christ is there, we're celebrating. You see that? He completely says, fasting, that's for mourning. These disciples have me here with them. They don't have time to mourn. This is a joyous occasion. You see, but the problem is, I want you to see the distinction here. Because the distinction is, the disciples of John and the Pharisees, they carry on business as usual. A lot like that newlywed that we read at the beginning of this. They're carrying on business as usual when the game has changed. It's different. Jesus is here. And their problem is, they're carrying on business as usual. All of their traditions, all of their rituals, all the things that they're doing, they're holding on to them instead of holding on to Christ. And then they're getting upset because the disciples aren't holding on to all those things. They've let them go, and they say, this is who we're waiting for. We're going to celebrate, and we're going to feast because we have Christ. Christ usurped those things. He found in him all the fulfillment of all the things in the past. All the Old Testament law found its fulfillment in Christ. And Jesus is showing it. It's in a small way, talking about fasting, but really going far further than fasting, proves and shows how all these things need to find their application in him. We see Jesus orienting all the religious exercises of fasting around his life and ministry. I want you to see that here, because no one else should be able to do that, right? No one else would say, well, since I'm in the room, no one should be fasting today. I mean, that'd be pretty selfish, wouldn't it? Like, you're mourning, you shouldn't be mourning, I'm here. But we recognize who Jesus is and what he has come to accomplish. We then recognize, yeah, we shouldn't be fasting. We should be celebrating because Jesus is here. Something that no one else understood but Jesus, and he was teaching the disciples this reality. And it's something, it's an idea that we see progressing through the Gospel of Matthew. I mean, we're going to see it in the upper room when they're about to take Passover, and then Jesus gets in there and he says, let me show you what this Passover meal is all about. And that's when he institutes the Lord's Supper. And we're like, this wasn't just about the escape from Egypt. This wasn't just about the Passover of the angel of death over the house. This was actually to foreshadow God passing over the sins of us through Jesus. Did you see that? Passover found its fulfillment in Christ. We're just saying this is a small example of what Jesus is going to continue to do throughout the Gospels as he is ushering in the new covenant. Now, at least at this juncture, we can sum it up this way. It's point number one. We need to recognize that Christ's arrival changed everything. Recognize that Christ's arrival changed everything. And we can begin making some application in our own life about how Jesus changes everything. I'm going to get to some places where, in Scripture in just a moment, where he changes the way that we interact with God via the new covenant. But I also want you to recognize, if you're in here and you're a new Christian, or you're somebody who's been a Christian for a long time, but like nothing, you're saying that nothing's changed in your life, I just want you to know, the Bible says that when Jesus enters, everything changes. It isn't business as usual. The way you relate to God through Christ, all of that changes everything about your life. What you're doing, what you're thinking, who you're spending your time with, what you find your mind entertaining, all those things change because of Christ. And I just want to leave that there for you so that you can let that percolate in your mind to say, you're right. When Jesus is present, things change. Things don't stay the same. The problem with our sin is things are always the same. Death entered through one man, Adam, and we inherited it as descendants of Adam, and we all recognize that we fall short of the glory of God, and the payment for that penalty, according to Romans, is? So if everything stayed the same, that would be problematic for you and I. But 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that that is just not the case. We are new creations, created in Christ Jesus. Well, that's Ephesians 2:10. But 2 Corinthians 5:17, you're new creations. The old has gone, the new has come. And then, Ephesians 2:10, you've been created for good works that he's prepared beforehand that you would walk in them. Things just aren't the same. So we can't be walking in our sin and living life without God and then saying, now I have God, but yet everything is still the same. Because when Jesus enters, everything's changed. Let me give you a couple of texts that at least help you from the Old Testament, Old Covenant, Law of Moses, Mount Sinai covenant with God, and the relationship that we have with God through Christ. Jot this text down, Hebrews 8:13. Hebrews 8:13. I can't hear your pens marking, but I just trust that you're writing it down. Hebrews 8:13, it says, and speaking of a new covenant, right? That's really what Hebrews is all about. It's actually talking to the Hebrews, right? The Hebrew people, Israel, talking about these Israelites. And the writer of Hebrews is showing these Jewish people that have the Hebrew backgrounds all the fulfillment of Christ in the New Testament concerning all of those ceremonial laws and rites that they had practiced for centuries. And here in verse 13, it says, in speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete, and what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. Did you see that? Those things are now obsolete. Animal sacrifices, obsolete in Christ. Purification rites, obsolete in Christ. You can't go and you can't sow two kinds of seed in one field, obsolete. You can't wear an article of clothing with two kinds of threads, obsolete. If not, we're all breaking the law of God right now. Look at your tag on your shirt. You're going to find, oh, no. So if they're not obsolete, you're going to find yourself disobeying the commands of God. But if they all find their purification and their sacrificial fulfillment in Christ, then it makes sense that things are whole in Christ. Things are pure in Christ. We have our sacrifice in Christ.
And the writer of Hebrews is speaking that. When Jesus came, speaking of this new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. It's gone. It's fulfilled. And at the time, particularly in that first century, even when Jesus was here, and this is what for some of you who may get confused a little bit, don't you, because I could, and I am a very confused person sometimes. When you think about when Jesus says things like this, like, hey, I've changed some things here. But then sometimes he goes and he tells people, now go to the temple and offer the sacrifices. That part, you've heard that. And you're like, well, why does he do both? Well, we have to understand the era and the time that Jesus was in. There were things that were, and I think this text helps it, they're growing old and ready to vanish away. I mean, there were still some things in the time of Jesus where he had not died on the cross yet, so there still was some Old Testament things going on. There were still sacrifices there at the temple. There was still Jesus saying, you need to obey the law of Moses because the new covenant has not been fully initiated until I die on that cross and that veil over there and that temple tears in two. And so you see a little bit of that, but what you also see is it's ready to vanish away, it's growing old, and it finds its ultimate obsolescence, if you will, at the cross of Christ as he dies there and the veil is torn, which signifies that God's presence is no longer in the temple, but now it's out, and at the day of Pentecost, it comes down on the people, and that's when we are called the temple of God. Does that all make sense so far? Jesus is beginning to explain this early on in the book of Matthew to the people, to his disciples. Colossians 2, it's another verse I want you to jot down. Colossians 2, 16 through 17. And this is really the application of Hebrews 8, 13, when Paul's talking to the church there in Colossae, in that region there in the Lycus Valley. He says this, therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in question of food and drink. Well, in the old covenant, there were food and drink laws, weren't there? You remember some of those? Those of you who like shrimp, you wouldn't have liked the old covenant. Couldn't eat those, okay? Because those things were unclean. You like bacon? I know you men like bacon. We have plenty of bacon here on men's Bible study. Couldn't eat bacon. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago, didn't we? When we were there on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Don't let people pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink. Or, listen to this, with regard to a festival, there were a lot of festivals in the old covenant, wasn't there? Feast of Booths, Yom Kippur, or a new moon, or a Sabbath. He's even saying, don't let people pass judgment on you when it comes to the Sabbath. Now, that's a controversial topic in our culture today. But like he's saying, like even the Sabbath, and I preached a whole sermon on this about 7 years ago, but the idea that the Sabbath finds its fulfillment in who? Christ. There still remains a rest, and that rest in Hebrews says it's Christ. And if you have not found that rest, you should seek diligently to enter that rest, and do not harden your heart. The Sabbath isn't about you kicking back in your lawn chair in the backyard. It's about ultimately finding your rest in Christ, because anyone who finds the rest in Christ ceases work. And Paul says here that don't let people pass judgment on you in the questions of food and drink and festival and new moon or Sabbath. Verse 17 is the key. These are shadows of things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. You want to find the substance of all of the things the Old Testament is talking about? The substance? You want to find the thing that you can grasp onto? The thing where all meaning and fulfillment is found? It's Christ. So when you read the Old Testament, you ought to read it and understand that it's all leading and culminating to Christ as the pinnacle of the covenant promises of God. I'm not telling you to find Christ in every single word of the Old Testament. I think that would be futile and unnecessary. But when you read them, you should recognize, oh, do you know what's going to solve this problem? Christ. The high priest had to sacrifice every year. You know what Christ had to do? Sacrifice one time. And then he sat down at the right hand of the Father because his work was done. He said it was finished. So when you read the Old Testament, you find beauty and glory in the Old Testament, because what you're doing is saying, I know how this ends. They're doing these things. These people had way less information than you and I, and when they were faithful, we think, wow, these people exercised such great faith, knowing that these promises that were promised to them, they didn't receive in their time. It's also what Hebrews says. But they trusted in God. And ultimately, they were doing those things not necessarily for them, is what Hebrews says, but for us. Because now we have the fulfillment, the culmination of these promises in Christ as that line of the seed of woman made its way throughout the Old Testament. And I'm just giving you just a biblical theology from the beginning to end here. But the idea of, like, you can look and you can see all of that stuff in the Old Testament. It was all leading up to Jesus. That's what the Gospel of Matthew is all about, is how Jesus became the fulfillment of everything that God had promised in the Old Testament. And all those things are a shadow of the things to come. The substance is Christ. And this is why I say you need to make sure that you're assessing what in the world you're doing. In the same way that Jesus is calling into question why in the world the disciples of John the Baptist and the Pharisees are fasting, because you may have been fasting for all sorts of reasons in the Old Testament, but if you're fasting, it has to do with Jesus. And Jesus is saying, this doesn't seem like the right time to fast right now because I'm here. No fasting when Jesus is here. Because we're celebrating because Jesus is here. Now, Jesus didn't outlaw fasting. We'll see that in a couple minutes. But you see how he says all that stuff about me. And you need to understand, if you're still doing it, you need to ask yourself, can I do this and say that I'm doing this to enhance and grow in my relationship with God through Christ? And if you can't, you need to start asking questions of why in the world that you're doing some of the things that you've been doing in your life. Talk to you a lot about those laws, right? The ceremonial laws, the sacrificial system. Like, I mean, just think about this, the sacrificial system. You had the guilt offering, the sin offering, the peace offering, the free will offering, the grain offering. Did you guys bring those with you this morning, by the way? You didn't, did you? No, why? Because you come under the offering of Christ, and what you offer to God is you. It's quite different, isn't it? You offer you because you are the living sacrifice, recognizing and understanding that Christ died for you, therefore you live for him as a sacrifice. So you're grateful that you don't live under the old covenant. You live under the new covenant. I don't have time, but I want you to think, even if you're like, ah, listen, I wasn't Jewish, I'm a Gentile, and now I'm saved. No, but even Ephesians 4:17 says, okay, then what is required of you? Ephesians 4, you can pop open there. Very quickly. I just opened up there automatically. Praise the Lord. There it is. Ephesians 4, starting in verse 17. Now this I say and I testify in the Lord that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. So the question is, are there still things for you to be participating in as a new covenant Christian? Yes. Right? You're not going to the temple and sacrificing animals, but yet, here it says, no, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. Right? There is a way that you were living outside of Christ. And this says, they're darkened in their understanding, they're alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But listen to this, but this is not the way that you learned Christ. So we're assuming, because the scripture's saying it, that if we learn Christ, then now there's a whole new way that I relate to God through Christ, and it means that there's things in my life that I need to pattern out and execute on a regular basis because of my new relationship with God in Christ. Right? We can all agree to that. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to watch this, put off your old self, somebody kill that cricket, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. And then the text goes on to talk about, okay, this is what the new life in Christ looks like. You want to begin putting habits and rituals and things in your life that you know you ought to be doing as a vessel of God, as a participant of the new covenant. Then it says, then put away falsehood. Let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. You see that? Now we're members of one another, right? We had no relationship to each other before. Now we're members of one another. So the new covenant of Christ changes the way that we relate to him and to each other. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his hands so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouth, but only such as good for building up as it fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Did you see how he ended that in the new covenant? As Christ forgave you, now you go and you make a practice out of these things. This is now how you live your life. This is now how you relate to God through the living sacrifice of your life. You're like, what does this have to do with fasting? It is a precursor of what Jesus is saying about the entire Christian life. If you want to fast, that's fine. We'll get to that in a moment. But you better be doing it in relationship to Christ. We're going to get to that right now. Here we go. Jesus doesn't outlaw fasting right here. But what he wants you to do is understand fasting is done for one reason. And we'll look at it. The rest of verse 15. It says, the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them. Now, it's important to understand as you're studying the Gospel of Matthew that this is the first time that we see an explicit reference of the snatching away of Jesus from the disciples, right? This is an aggressive word that means he's going to be grabbed away violently, which is a precursor to the reality that he's going to the cross. And remember, John the Baptist had been snatched away from his disciples. And as we read in the Gospels, Jesus says, and likewise, I too will be taken away. And here he says, I'm going to be taken away from the disciples, and then they will fast. So, okay, these people still relating to Christ. The new covenant, he's ushering that in and showing us some glimpses of it, and then they will fast. So once Christ is taken away, goes to the cross, there will be mourning. There's mourning when we see the Passion Week. We'll be looking at over the next few weeks. There's mourning. There is time for people to fast, but I want you to pay attention to what the entire central focus is. The fast now finds its centrality in who? Christ. Who did the fast of the Pharisees and John the Baptist center on? I don't know. You'd have to ask them. But it certainly didn't center on Christ. Why? Because when Christ was there, they weren't centering their fast on Christ. And then Jesus says, okay, now I'm going to be taken away because right now we're celebrating. The bridegroom's in the house, but the bridegroom's going to be taken away. And then the disciples will fast. And so what Jesus is saying here is there is time for fasting. And even for you in the Christian life, there's time for fasting. But I'll get there in a minute. Don't let me jump too quick. All right. Fasting finds its rationale. It finds its entire purpose through the relationship the disciples have with Christ. They're not fasting according to the old covenant in Christ. They're not fasting for obscure or nebulous reasons, and that would fall into a big category of why most people in our day fast. Right? Why do we fast? It's just a religious thing that I do, or I don't know, it just makes me feel better. That's not why we fast. We don't fast for religious experientialism. That's not what fasting is for. Jesus is saying here, you know why the disciples are going to fast soon? Because I'm not going to be there. And that is something to mourn about. You want to know a big reason why you can fast in this day? When you look around and in a real way, and you have to be honest as a Christian, in a real way, Jesus is not here. Right? That's not unspiritual. You know why Jesus is not here? Because he's there. You know what we're waiting for? Jesus to come here. Right? That's the most biblical thing you can say. Is Jesus is not here, he's there, and I look around at the world around me and I mourn, whether it's my personal sin, whether it's maybe sometime you've been a part of a church where there's inherent sin in the church and you're sinning, you're mourning and you're fasting because of the corporate sin of your church, or maybe you look around at the world around you and there's national sin and you may fast because of that. Ultimately, you're not necessarily just fasting because bad things are happening. You're fasting because you recognize that Jesus isn't here, and I want Jesus here, and I want to focus on Jesus, so I'm going to fast, I'm going to stop eating, and I'm going to focus on him, because that's what I want more of, Jesus. And I want you to do this before we get into some more application. I want you to reevaluate your own spiritual practices. Reevaluate your own spiritual practices. If you do things like fasting, great, but I want you to really ask yourself the question, why do you do it? And I know we live in a culture of health. Well, we don't live in a culture of health, but there are people who like to be healthy. And they say, well, fasting's good. Yeah, by all means, I know that there are health benefits of fasting for lots of reasons. But number one, God's probably not going to ask you to do a lot of things. I mean, probably it's better if you don't eat pork. Okay, probably is. It just probably is. But that's not the point of why God told them not to eat pork. Don't eat pork because God says it's unclean, it's unholy, you're not going to eat it. You're going to separate from the nations around you who eat pork, and you're not. We have in Christ the freedom to eat what we choose, okay? And all I want us to make sure that we're doing is saying, if you're fasting for any reason other than to draw near to God through Christ, call it what it is. I'm going on a diet. Unspiritual, just diet. I'm going and I'd like to lose a couple of pounds. I'd like to stop eating so much sugar. Right, Lent, even Lent, right? That's a big one, right? Stop saying I'm going to stop playing Mario Kart on Saturdays as my Lent. That is not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is what are you doing to relate to God through Christ in your spiritual disciplines, in the spiritual practices of your life? And we're going to say, is fasting an appropriate thing? Well, the question is, it depends. Why are you doing it? Are you doing it because you're longing for us? I actually wrote something I want to read to you because I feel like sometimes I can write it better than I can speak it. Why do you fast? Fasting is a spiritual discipline. It's one among many, right? It's not the only way people relate to God through Christ in their own spiritual disciplines, but it is one among many to draw near to God through Christ, depriving ourselves for a time of life-giving nourishment to focus on the life-giving power of Christ. We do not fast for acceptance, to make God listen to us, or to force God to do what we ask. But knowing our proclivity to cling to creature comforts in times of distress, fasting is a reminder that we find our sufficiency and our comfort in Christ and nothing else. Fasting is to say nothing will do but Jesus. And when we need that reminder, by all means, fast. That's what fasting is. And that's how we ought to think about fasting. But let me tell you this. It's about, and I have to apply a little bit differently, but that's everything else in your life. Why do you, we're talking about baptismal regeneration. Like, you know, which if you believe, if you are and you came from a culture or a background that believes that baptism saves you, like getting into the water, the act of baptism regenerates you, it saves you. Whether you come from a Catholic background or whether you come from some branches of the Church of Christ or other backgrounds where that water gives you... No. Jesus saves you. And they'll say, well, we believe Jesus saves you. We just believe that Jesus, God has now given it, that this water, that he is now blessed, and that's through the blood of Christ, but through this water, and now you put that water on you, now you have the blood of Christ on you. Nonsense. Stop making things about things that are not about Jesus. The water is a symbol, which we'll get to that later. Transubstantiation, another Catholic doctrine. Not here to bash all the Catholic theology, maybe a little bit, but not, because I want you to see transubstantiation. What is that? That's the Lord's Supper, and it is the wine and the bread that turn into Christ. I don't need things to turn into Christ. I have Christ. I don't need those things. Not that I don't need them. The Bible doesn't explain to you at all that those elements turn into the body of Christ. They don't. That is a tradition and ritual of man through history that has created something that the Bible says nothing about. And they said, well, when you eat this, you're eating the blood, or drinking the blood, and eating in the body, and those things that confers grace upon you. It's like, no, what confers grace unto me is Christ, and that I would trust in him, and he would give me grace. And when I need grace, I go to the Father through the Son, and the Holy Spirit intercedes for me on my behalf to the Father. That's the grace that we need, and it ain't through the things that you're doing with this ritual and that rite. Those things don't make you right with God. All right, but let's get away from like super religious words, but even like those people, you know, like baseball players, like, I never wash my socks. You know those people? They say, I never wash, you know why? Because I won a Little League World Series in these socks, and I'm 27 years old in the minor leagues, and I still ain't washed these socks. I'm going to say, sick, right? And I'm saying, like, now to get to the heart of that, why are you doing that? Because do you believe something about those socks? You're believing something special, some special grace that those socks would give to you that would allow you to do something extraordinary? It's like, I'm just saying, why would a Christian, for instance, a good question, why would a Christian who is a Christian witness who is showing people who God is in Christ in their life say, my lucky socks did it? No. Do you believe in the sovereignty of God? Do you trust God's goodness and his plan in your life, whether you're running bases or raising children? Then it ain't the socks that did it. It's God who gives. It's God who takes away. It's God who sustains. You see what I'm saying here? Even if it's not the sacramental system that you grew up with, I'm just talking about you as a Christian. Be thinking about what in the world are you doing and why are you doing it? Because those dirty, nasty socks have nothing to do with Christ and empowering you, as Paul says, to deal with much or to deal with little. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But this is not about hitting baseballs and making touchdowns. It's all about Jesus gives me the grace that I need to carry on. And how are you displaying that, both reminding yourself of that and showing the world that truth? Now I'm saying, you want to fast to get more of that? You go fast. And if you lose a couple of pounds on the way, glory to God. But that's just not what it's about. Are we following me? Does that make sense so far? Because if I've lost you, let me know, because I'll have to try to find you. You want to talk about the Sabbath a little bit more? Okay. The Sabbath, this is a good one. People, I need my Sabbath. I need my day off. Or I need time off. I'm like, okay, why? Why do you need your day off? Because if you're telling me that you're getting your day off for any other reasons, but that you remind yourself of your need to find your rest in Jesus Christ, then I'm going to say you're not even applying the Sabbath of the Old Testament correctly. Much less even applying it now, although it's been fulfilled in Christ, because we all believe that God has created in the patterns of the universe that on the seventh day, God rested, and it is a good thing for all of us to rest, but you got to recognize what is rest. Because if you point to anything but Christ, you've got it wrong. Because if you don't have Christ, you can rest one day a week for the rest of your life, and you will never find rest. You find your rest in Christ. And if you want to say, yes, in Christ, now on Sundays, I Sabbath, ultimately because I find my rest in Christ, and you're going to say, I'm going to say amen to that. But then I'm going to say, okay, so what does that fast look like? Well, I go to the lake every Sunday, and I throw that line in the lake because I am Sabbathing. No, you're not. No, you're not. You're selfishly using God as an excuse why you get to go do what you want to do. Because if I'm going to Sabbath rest, I'm preaching to the choir. If I'm going to Sabbath rest, you know where I'm going to do that? With the family of God who have found their rest in Christ. And we come together feasting on Christ, resting in Christ, and living our lives for Christ. And we leave here, and guess what we feel? Rested. And if you want to go home and you don't want to put your hand to the plow and you don't want to yoke your oxen together when you get home because you want to say, I'm not trusting in the work, I'm not trusting in the chariot, I'm not trusting in the horses, I'm not trusting in the bank system, I'm not trusting in the government, I'm trusting in Christ, then I'm going to say, you go home and you lay your head on that pillow and you remind yourself that that's right. But that's not why people Sabbath these days, is it? And that's my concern. You want a Sabbath, you go Sabbath, but you make sure that Sabbath points you and everyone else to Jesus. And this is all that Jesus is doing in this entire time. It's saying, it is changed. It is finished. Everybody finds their fullness in me, not in the rituals of the past. Not in washing your stanky socks. In me. All right, now Jesus proves all this, and now I want to help, put the last nail in the coffin, so to speak, to give you these illustrations that explain this new covenant arrangement, which, to be honest, was one of the most mysterious texts to me for years, but it makes sense if you think about it. Look at verse 16 in Matthew 9. No one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. News to me, all right? Glad I did not fix your clothes recently. No one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch tears away from the garment and a worse tear is made. You need to know how, we need to explain? All right, old garments, the things that we wear a lot and we wash, well, as you know, some of us, right, when you wash your clothes, they shrink. And some of you need to come to grips with, it didn't shrink that much, you grew a little bit, all right? But generally speaking, your clothes, they shrink. Okay, now if I get a patch, if I get rip a hole in some of that older clothing, and then I need to get a patch, and it's a new patch, and it hasn't been shrunk, and I put it on there, and I sew it up, and I'm so proud of my work, and then I throw that thing in the washer and dryer a couple times, and I wear them a couple times, and I throw them back in the washer and dryer a couple times, what's going to happen? It's going to pull away. Because it shrunk and it ripped, and now it's worse than it was before. And Jesus is saying, this is what it's like for you to try to entrap the grace of Christ in the new covenant with all of the Old Testament rituals and practices. for you to try to put the goodness of Christ and make it religious practices and rituals that I do every day. I mean, if you've at least connected a couple dots of why Jesus is so focused on talking to the Pharisees and those, quit making this about outward things. This is an inward reality. This is a matter of the heart, not a matter of the flesh. It's a matter of the heart. We and they could not contain the goodness of God in Christ in the vessels of the old covenant. Couldn't do it. And he explains it just like you can't put a new piece of cloth on an old garment and expect it to stick. Neither, verse 9, 17, is new wine put into old wineskins. And if you thought I knew nothing about clothes, you better just check my knowledge on wine. Know nothing. Nothing about wine. Neither is new wine put in old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst and the wine is spilled and the skins are destroyed. Well, I know this much. Wineskins used to be made out of leather skins of animals. And when they put grape juice, as they crushed it and they put it in these vats, and then after that, after it fermented for a little while, they put it in these wineskins. And you know the chemical makeup and reaction of wine and glass, don't you? I don't. But I do know, I get it. Science, I get it. Okay. You put the wine in there, and as it consumes the sugar in there, it creates gases, and the gases expand the skin. And that skin, as it expands, fits very nicely with the wine that's in there, okay? Because it expanded, it's living, it's home, it's doing great things, and it's thin, but it fits because it stretches that skin out. Well, when all that wine's gone and they pour new wine skin in it, and that skin is already brittle and stretched out, well, guess what's going to happen when they fill that thing up with new wine that's then going to expand it again? What's going to happen? It's going to burst. And Jesus is saying, you cannot put what I have brought into the old wineskins of the old covenant. Cannot do it. You cannot hold the grace of Christ in the sacramental system. Whether you are in ancient Judaism, whether you're in the Catholic Church today, or whether you are in here and you have no religious affiliation, but you believe that it's the things that you do that save you, you can't hold the grace of Christ in your doing. It's never going to happen. You need new wineskin. And the new wineskin is the grace of Christ and the new covenant that he ushered in, that if you would recognize your sin, you would turn from your sin, you'd place your trust in him, you then would receive the new covenant in the container of Christ, in the goodness of God. That's the new wineskin. That's the new wine. Now, if you do that, it says, the new wine is put into fresh wineskin, and so both are preserved. A lot of people, they're like, I just feel like my Christian faith, it doesn't make sense, or I just feel like I'm longing. It feels like the wine is all spilled all over the ground because it just doesn't, yeah, I just don't feel fulfilled. It's because, are you trying to fit new wine and old wineskins? Are you trying to fit Jesus in your life as usual? Are you trying to make things about you and you pepper a little bit of Jesus on there? Well, that's going to splat all over the ground every single time. We're going to do baptisms in a couple weeks, and I promise you that there is no one who we can dip into that water enough to wipe the sin off them that Christ hasn't dealt with. Christ has to deal with the sin. You want to be clean, it has to be through Christ. Not the act of baptism, not the act of the Lord's Supper, not the act of doing all these good things, hoping that I can get right with God eventually. Then you're going to say, well, what was the law of Moses? What were those rituals? What were those traditions? Scripture says that they were placeholders. Romans says they were guardians until Christ arrived. Those things, they were there as a little placeholder to say all of these things, which we need reminders of. Why? You think about Christ. So why do we need Christ? Well, because we're sinners. Well, how did you know you were a sinner? Enter the law of Moses. That's how you know you're a sinner. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. How did you know those things? Because God gave it to Israel on Mount Sinai. Those things were placeholders. They were guardians that explained, here's the problem, bright and clear. And then Christ comes in, here's the solution. So there's, at least in a small part, what those things, those laws, those rituals, those traditions expressed is they were realities that Christ has since fulfilled. They were shadows. Christ is the substance. Now, I've said this, and I'm going to say it again. It doesn't mean that there are no rites and rituals today. There are. There very much are. We're going to talk about a number of them. You know a lot of them. Like, for people to say, well, yeah, those religious rituals and rites, they mean nothing. No. That's also very unbiblical. It's so unbiblical because Jesus literally introduced rites and rituals into the Christian faith as reminders and symbols of what he did. So don't diminish what Christ has commanded in the church. But what we at least need to do is we need to embrace those, don't we? Point number three, we need to embrace the new covenant realities of Christ. We need to embrace the new covenant realities of Christ. As you're writing, you can listen if you can write and listen. Like I said earlier, Passover finds its fulfillment in Christ. That's why we separate the Lord's Supper. It's a continuation and really a redirection of what the Passover is. Now we celebrate the Passover, but we celebrate the Passover of Christ's sacrifice on our behalf, that God would pass over our sins. And the blood of Christ covers us. So that's one we continue today, but there are others like animal sacrifices we don't celebrate today. We don't do those things today. Because those things have found their ultimate fulfillment in Christ as being our sacrifice on the cross. We need to embrace new covenant realities. I want to give you an example of another ritual that has become void. Okay, here's a ritual that we see in the Old Testament that has become void in the new covenant. Galatians 5, 1 through 6. Galatians 5, 1 through 6. Paul says, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery." Paul is literally in the same vein of thought that you and I are in right now. He's saying, you in Christ have been set free from the regulations of the old covenant. All those things, you've been set free from those. So stand firm and don't submit again to that yoke of slavery that you got to do all these things in order to merit favor with God. That the pressure that the world puts on you to do these things. Now watch, and Paul then explicitly talks about what he's talking about. Look, verse 2, "I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision," so I assume you know what circumcision is, that was a sign of the old covenant of all of the male children had to be circumcised as a covenant of their inclusion in God's people. It was a reminder for them that they did a physical act that they did to be in that covenant family of God. You know how so serious God took circumcision? That literally, if you read in Exodus 4, God kindles his anger with Moses because he did not circumcise his son. And then mom jumps in when God is about to kill the son and whips over there and circumcises their son real quick so that God's wrath would relent. Like, that's how jealous God was about the act of circumcision, because circumcision showed that you were mine. But here, how serious God was about that. But you know, here, Paul's saying that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. So Christ has to be advantageous for us when it comes to the old laws, those rituals that we used to do. Why is Christ advantageous? Because he fulfilled those and they became obsolete. "I testify again," verse 3, "to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed," which pun intended, "from Christ. You who would be justified by the law, you have fallen away from grace." Right? Again, you don't go to those sacramental rituals and as a means for you to find the grace in Christ. "For through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness." So we, by the Spirit of God, by faith in Christ, that's what we're eagerly waiting for, and that's the hope of our righteousness. Now, everything that you do, all the rituals that we do, baptism, Lord's Supper, giving, serving, worshiping, we do that all for one reason, that by faith in Christ, we are eagerly waiting for the hope of righteousness, which is the coming of Christ. "For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love." So what do we do? Why do we do it? Really a question you have to answer. And I'll give you at least a couple of these, right? I've alluded to a number of them. There are new covenant realities, symbols of our relationship with Christ that you ought to do. And since they still exist, they're meaningful, and you need to recognize your participation in them. If they were not purposeful and meaningful, they would have become obsolete. So there are a lot of things that became obsolete that you heard this morning. There are some things that are still active in the church today. One of those is baptism, right? It's a symbol of purification. It's the symbol of dying with Christ and being raised again. Like The animal sacrifices, they killed the animal sacrifice. The worshiper had to slit the throat of the animal sacrifice. If you didn't know that, killed it. And the death of that animal symbolized life for the worshiper. Did you see that? We don't do that anymore. Because we have Christ who bled and died for us, and we don't go sacrifice animals, but what we do is we get in the baptistry, and we, as a symbol of the purity that we have in Christ, the righteousness that we have, we go into the water, and then we come up as also a symbol of dying and raising to new life. So that's why we talk about baptism. That's why it's so important, because it is still one of those ordinances that Christ commanded that we ought to do, not because it saves us, but because it helps us understand what Christ has done symbolically. And it does, as Galatians 5 says, we eagerly await for the hope of righteousness that baptism signifies, that Christ is coming back to take us to be with him. And so you ask, should I be baptized? The answer is absolutely. Because you want to remind yourself and show the whole congregation what in the world Christ has done in your life and what that signifies. The Lord's Supper, right? Passover, talked about it, right? We celebrate the Lord's Supper. You take the wafer, you take the cup, and we drink the cup, we eat the wafer as a remembrance of what Christ has done for us. Not so that God will love me, because that is a symbol of God's love for you. You see that? We're not working for God's love. We are remembering God's love, and we're participating together as a church in remembering the love of God for his church through the blood and the body of Christ. Let me give you one more. Giving, right? Tithing, giving, right? You know, there is so many giving and tithing in the Old Testament, a lot of it. They didn't just give. You read the Old Testament, usually you're like, oh yeah, tithe, 10%. There were lots of tithes, okay? You have the Levitical tithe for the Levites to be able to take care of the temple and do all the things they needed to do. You have the poor tithe. You have the festival tithe. You had the free will tithe, right? Which is, hey, God's blessed me. I want to give back to God. All these different tithes. And if you really add it up, and that's not all of them, but you add up all the tithes of the Old Testament, you're not getting 10% of your stuff. Like, you're not talking about 10% of your things. You're talking about 30, 40, 50 more percent of your money, your produce, your things go to God. Okay, so that's when we talk about tithing, so I want to give 10%. It's like, well, why? Right? Again, why do you do that religious ritual? Right? Because if you do it according to the Old Testament, it's a lot more than 10%. But we don't adhere to that in our time because we do not fall under the ceremonial laws. Right? What we fall under is the law of grace, the law of Christ, which says that we give out of the abundance of our heart. We set aside as a sacrifice to the Lord. No number attached to it, no percentage, but what you recognize in your life as a sacrifice unto the Lord because of Christ, you give that. You set that apart. Seems more simple, doesn't it? People would argue, though, that, and I don't want to argue from the pulpit because I'm the pastor, but I read a commentary that's talking about, well, does that mean that we give more or less? Well, how much more is Christ worth than the old covenant? That made us feel uncomfortable, didn't it? The reality is you're giving and you're sacrificing and all the other things you do in relation to your relationship, you do in regard to your relationship with Christ. When you give, you're giving as a remembrance of what Christ has done, and you're giving it expecting those finances will be used to propagate that message to the world. And then you ask how much I ought to give to make that happen. It's a different way to think about it. It's a biblical way to think about it that really encapsulates and defines how you ought to be dealing with the religious rituals of your life. And some of these, according to what we do as a church, you ought to remember why we do these things, because they're important. And I hope this has allowed you to assess the value of these spiritual practices. And I hope that they show you how these things find their fulfillment in Christ. And I expect and I trust that it's going to change the way that you think about your relationship with God in Christ, and how you will take seriously the things that we continue to do today. You would take seriously even walking out of here and walking with Christ, peripateo, living your life for Christ, recognizing that none of those things are meaningless, and all of those things ought to be done in the way that you relate to Christ. Let's pray.